going to ask you this question. But this question was asked to 17,000 people over 21 years old in the United States. How many people admitted that they believe in ghosts? Look around you, see who's trying to hide their faces. They're probably one of them. It was 63%. Now, they asked that same group of people, have you ever had a personal experience with a ghost? 46% said, yes, they had. Now, here's a group of people that you can look through and recognize. There's TV stars, there's singers, there's movie stars, musicians, there's presidents, presidents' wives, queens and princesses. When people come to Virginia Beach, whether they're believers or not, one of the first things they say is, well, it can't be haunted here. It's too new. It's a nice new city. There can't be hauntings. But if you're from here or you live in Norfolk, you probably know that on April 27th, 1607, English settlers, about 115 or 120 of them, stepped ashore at Cape Henry. There are Indian graves in our area. In 1968, Floyd Painter was excavating and exploring in the area that is now, Green Hill, near my neighborhood, which, by the way, my house is haunted. And they found several remains of Native Americans and or indigenous people. And the question was what to do with them after they'd found them. So they agreed, they got a shaman from all the local tribes, and they consecrated some land at First Landing State Park. And there is a plaque there now and a little prayer circle where the remains, 46 remains, are interred there. Now, in addition to finding Indian graves, on April 1720, 14 bodies washed up at Cape Henry. Now, in this situation, they were assumed to be victims of piracy because their hands were tied behind them or their feet were tied together. Not being able to identify them, either by name or by association, what ship they were from, they were just buried right there on the beach. And sometimes if I have children on my ghost walk, I'll tell them, you know, if you find a shell on the beach and it looks like a little finger, it might be. You guys have a sense of humor. Most parents don't. They just think, oh, God, we're done. So the importance of Cape Henry was very obvious, and it was necessary to build a lighthouse there. The problem was who would do it. Why should the Crown do it? Because, you know, it was a trade situation. Why should the Crown spend money over here? Just let us struggle. So, then there's this unpleasantness with the war and all that kind of stuff, which ended in 1791, although the last battle was in 1781. And George Washington was elected president in 1786, and one of the first things he did was commission the construction of a lighthouse. It was completed in 1791. It was the first public program or project built by the federal government. It cost amazingly $15,500 of hardworking taxpayers' money. Unfortunately, for a federal program, it set a bad example because that one's still around, but other federal programs from 15 years ago aren't around anymore. So, but this was the way it was supposed to be done. And there was a great interest in keeping the sailors safe as much as possible. Now we're gonna move forward a few years to 1848, and the federal government formed the U.S. Life-Saving Service. Their goal was to have a life-saving station along every coast, the Atlantic, the Gulf Coast, and the Pacific. They would be stationed 7 miles apart. And they got started in New England, but then this other war broke out and slowed things down a little bit. So at the end of the Civil War, they came back and they started building these life-saving stations. Now, the first one in our district, which was District 2, was Cape Henry. That was built in 1784, and then they went down to North Carolina and built their first station, and then came back 4 years later and continued the construction. So this is the SeaTac Life-Saving Station. This is at 25th and Atlantic currently, and it's called the SeaTac Life-Saving Station, and there's two stories about that name. Either it's a place where the ships leaving Chesapeake Bay would have to tack their sailing ships to get out onto the ocean course, or in the War of 1812, after the British had burned our Capitol building, they anchored offshore and sent a small party ashore in that area to get fresh water from the swamp. Those sailors or soldiers were met by the local militia, and a small skirmish broke out, and The big guns on the ships at sea opened fire on the militia, so it became known as this Area of the Sea Attack, which got shortened to SeaTac. No definitive proof about which is which. Now, you'll notice the building is rather small, and it has just a little flat surface on the roof. And that was essential because of the way that men would watch. During the day, they could sit up on the tower at an elevated position and be able to see at least 3.5 miles in either direction, and then the other life-saving stations could see 3.5 miles. But at night, standing on the top doesn't do any good, so they would actually patrol the beaches on a 4-hour shift, and we'll say 8 o'clock at night, two men from the station two, that was the SeaTac station, one would go north and one would go south, carrying with them a lantern and a red flare and a little badge with his number on it and probably some snacks, canteen or something, and they would walk 3.5 miles north. The Cape Henry man would walk 3.5 miles south. They'd meet up in the center, and since they're both getting paid the same, they're going to find out the exact center where that's going to be. Build a little halfway house. When they meet up with each other, they exchange badges. They go back and show the captain of the station, hey, I've got Charlie's badge. I completed my rounds. Then they walk back and then get their own badges and come back. So in 4 hours, they're walking 14 miles. Not on the beach, but on the dunes. So these were healthy individuals. Now, in this time period, they noticed that lighthouse, the old Cape Henry lighthouse, was starting to crack a little bit, and they didn't think it was going to last much longer, so they started construction on a new lighthouse. Now, in this picture, you can see the old Cape Henry lighthouse in the background. Now, that's up on a hill on a sand dune, and it's only 90 feet high. It's not the biggest lighthouse around, but it was adequate for the times. Now, in the foreground there, you see what looks like maybe an oil drum or a trash can. But if you look at the bottom left of the picture, there's a little red circle, and there's two men standing in that little red circle. That's to give you some perspective. This is actually the base of the new Cape Henry Lighthouse, which was finished in 1881. Now, it was and still is the largest cast iron lighthouse in the United States. They had discovered a new way to identify the lighthouses. Now, at night, every lighthouse has its own code. You know, their rotating beacons are set up so that you might get one long flash and then two short ones, and you could look on your chart and tell what lighthouse it was. But during the day, they all look the same. So they came up with this idea of putting geometric patterns on the lighthouse. Now, this is the Cape Henry lighthouse. There's no other lighthouse on the East Coast like that one. Black and white, it's good contrast, so they can see it out at sea, not be mistaken. By the time they got to the West Coast, they were repeating the patterns, but to avoid confusion, they made them red and white. I'm going to tell you about a shipwreck that happened in 1892, and I'm going to give you a little background information. There wasn't much to the town of Virginia Beach then. There was the life-saving station, and across the dirt road, there was what was called Government Square, and that's where the federal government provided housing for the surfmen and all that. Now, between what is now 14th and 16th Street, there was a huge hotel called the Princess Anne Hotel. Now, the Princess Anne Hotel had its own electrical generating plant. It had a train station. It had a telegraph station there. It was incredible. It was the most popular place on the East Coast. And the story I'm going to tell you takes place in Easter, on the Easter weekend of 1892. Now, the Princess Anne Hotel opened in 1888, and it burned to the ground in 1906. But it was the place to be in 1892. Several presidents had stayed there, as well as Alexander Graham Bell and other very famous people. So imagine Easter Sunday. Well, let's imagine Good Friday, because that's when the wreck actually happened. Good Friday morning, everybody's gathered to have breakfast, and they see this beat-up ship go by. So let me tell you. The ship was the Dictator. This is the captain's wife, Joanna Pauline, and little Carl Zeeland Jorgensen. Zeeland is not a Norwegian name, if you didn't know that. But Carl was born in the island of New Zealand, so that was his name. The captain was Jorgen, whose father was also Jorgen. So the captain was Jorgen Jorgensen, okay, and then Joanna Pauline and their son. Now, they set sail along with the crew of Norwegians, 17 of them in total, from Florida, sailing to Hartlepool, England with a cargo of pine lumber, which was as good as gold. Imagine England, as old as it is, and relying on wood for everything, housing, fuel, boats, everything. These pine trees, nice, tall, straight pine trees, were just great. So this was a wonderful treasure. So they left Florida. What they would do is sail north to Bermuda, then they would turn east and sail to the European coast and then negotiate themselves to where they actually needed to be. Not Moss, Norway was the ultimate goal, but first they were going to go to Hartlepool, England. Now, the captain had not told his wife or any of the crew that this was a special occasion. He had purchased a house in Moss, Norway, and he was going to surprise his wife. They'd never lived in a house before. Carl had never even been in a house before. So this was going to be his gift to her, his last cruise. He was going to retire, move to Moss, Norway, and house with a little picket fence and all that. So when the ship approached Bermuda and went to turn east, well, they encountered a horrible storm, by all accounts, a severe hurricane, and it stopped the ships dead in its tracks because the surf and the wind were in its face. They were battered. They heard a mast crack, but it stayed up, fortunately. One of their lifeboats came loose from the davits and dashed itself against the side of the boat, so their one lifeboat, or one of two lifeboats, was destroyed. Water was coming in the ship. And the only person who wasn't Norwegian was a Frenchman named John Baptiste, and he was the first mate. And John was making sure that the pumps were hard at work. Now, manual pumps, you got two or four guys operating the pumps. Well, they were having a little luck, so John Baptiste came up to the captain and said, "Captain, why don't we just go to Norfolk? Okay, they have a shipyard there, they can fix our trouble. You know, we're taking on water, we have a cracked mast, we could use some repair, and the boys could take a couple days off. They wouldn't mind that at all." Captain Jorgensen's like, "Nope, we're moving forward." I mean, he couldn't let anything stop this. This was his special trip, you know, he was gonna surprise the daylights out of his wife. So back to the pumps, everybody's still working. John Baptiste comes up again, he goes, "Oh, my captain, you know, these boys love Joanna as a mother, but sir, they also believe that a woman on board a ship is bad luck. Now, if you don't do something about these conditions, they're threatening to throw her overboard." And the captain was like, no, I know these boys, I'll go down and talk with them." So he does. Now, Captain Jorgensen had a lot of experience as a sailor. He had a father who was a sailor. By all accounts, he was a good husband and a good father. Okay, but like I said, you don't have to be real smart to be a ship captain. In fact, apparently, there's only two things that you need to know to be a ship captain in those days, okay? Ship in the water, good. Water in the ship, bad. Okay. So Jorgen went down below decks, and there was water in his ship, and he knew, this is bad. So he told the boys, "We're turning around, we're going for Norfolk," and there was much rejoicing. So now they're sailing due west from Bermuda into this storm. This storm continues for 3 days. So on Good Friday morning, about 4 a.m., one of the lookouts screams that he can see land. So everybody runs to the rail. Now, sand dunes in were about 80 feet high, and they're white. And you get the white beach, and you got the surf with white foam, and you got gray overcast skies. So without any landmarks, you know, well, yeah, we found land. And that's what Captain Jorgensen said, "Guys, the good news is land. Bad news is I'm not really sure where we are. But I do know that the prevailing winds and currents have pushed us south of where we need to be. All we need to do is sail north. We'll find Cape Henry, go into Norfolk, and we'll be repaired." And everybody was good with that. So they started sailing up the coast as best they could. Northeast wind, and they're sailing north, so it wasn't too bad. And after another hour or so, somebody screamed out, "There's the lighthouse." Everybody runs to the rail. Captain walks to the rail and goes, "No, there's no lighthouse there." John Baptiste is standing there. John says, "Oh yes, Captain, this is Cape Henry." Captain says, "John, Cape Henry has not one, but two lighthouses. I don't see a lighthouse, do you? But Captain, this has been a terrible storm. It's lasted for several days. It's possible that those lighthouses have been destroyed. Certainly blown out would not be beyond question. I don't know, John. I just don't believe it. Captain, I've been here before. On my oath, this is Cape Henry. So the captain didn't want to be unpopular and say no, so he succumbed against his better judgment, and he started coming into shore. And doesn't make any difference who was right or who was wrong, but that wasn't Cape Henry. Okay, it was a place called False Cape. And they call it that because people falsely mistake it for Cape Henry. And there's lots of shipwrecks there, but the dictator wasn't one of them, because the captain went in so slowly he was able to pull out, but he still couldn't get so far from the shore. So he was stuck. He'd have to go a little bit west or a little bit east, and then northwest, and a little bit east, and a little bit northwest. And of course, the problem was every time he tacked to come in on that northwest course, the winds and rain or winds and tides behind him could push him up further onto the beach. And so at roughly 9 o'clock on Good Friday morning, the dictator, battered as it could be, struggles up the coast, and everybody at the Princess Anne Hotel watches them go by, and they've never seen a ship before. They didn't know if that was a good sign or a bad sign, but, you know, it got their attention, and they watched it go up north and disappear in the fog, and they didn't think of it anymore. But about 10:30, the dictator succumbed to the elements and ran aground. Now, if you're a landlubber, you might not appreciate the fact that running aground is not a good thing. I mean, wait, you're on the ground. That's true, but you're in water over a man's head, and you're in a boat. Now, a boat is designed to be in the water, not on the land. And so once they strike the ground, they start to break up pretty quickly. So over the course of the next several hours, the dictator broke apart. It was every man for himself. A few men managed to get away on the breeches buoy, but Joanna would not ride on that crazy thing. So she stayed behind. So at the very end, it was Captain Jorgensen, his wife, his son, and John Batiste. And a ladder was banging up against the side of the boat. So Captain Jorgensen said, I'm going to go get in the ladder, and I'll come back and get Carl, and then I'll come back and get Joanna, and then John can jump in the water. We'll ride the ladder into shore. It didn't work out. He got Carl, put Carl around his neck, wave toppled him over. Carl didn't come up. Jorgen was just swimming around trying to find his son. In the meantime, his wife and John Batiste had to jump overboard. Captain Jorgensen washed ashore, almost unconscious. At this time, it's dark. There's bonfires on the beach. He's wandering around asking if anybody had seen his wife and child. No, sir. So the next morning, Saturday morning, those people at the Princess Anne got quite a surprise when they looked out the window. It must have looked like Lowe's or Home Depot on Father's Day. I mean, the beach was just covered with stacks of lumber everywhere. And, you know, people were looking for victims and survivors. And so the people from the hotel got out in their Sunday best, and they were out there looking for survivors on the beach. By the end of Saturday, they had 9 survivors, 6 fatalities, well, 5 fatalities. Carl, Joanna, and John Batiste hadn't been found. Easter Sunday morning, John Batiste and Joanna wash ashore almost hand in hand, but nobody saw Carl. So they called off the search. The people from the hotel gave Captain Jorgensen $400 to give to the families whose sailors had, whose husbands and fathers had been killed. Okay. Then they boarded a train. The fatalities were buried in Norfolk, and the survivors took a train up to Baltimore. Shipwrecks happen a lot around here, so it wasn't really the topic of conversation for very long. But the next week, in a little village a few miles south of Virginia Beach, it was on a Saturday morning, and a man went out to go fishing. So he comes out to the beach, he has his net over his shoulder, he's wading out in the water, and he stumbles. He reaches down, pulls up the body of a little boy. Looks to be about 5 years old, bloated. He doesn't know what to do. I mean, they live on a coastal plain. They know about shipwrecks. They've experienced shipwrecks before. But to find a young boy, how tragic is that? And he doesn't know what to do, so he says, I'll take him to the preacher. The preacher will know. So he takes the boy to the preacher, who's asleep, puts him on the porch steps or the church steps and goes fishing. Well, when the preacher does get up, he comes to the door and, Oh, what a beautiful, beautiful day. I'll write my sermon for tomorrow. But first, I have to do something with this dead baby. And he knew his parish very well. He knew nobody had a child. He could see the coast, and he could see no shipwrecks. There had been no news of a shipwreck. And so rather than upset his parishioners, he went behind the church and buried the baby. Just covered him up and let it go. Now, the next morning, this is a small little community. They have one communal building, and it's part of the church, and they have a little wood-burning stove in there. And so after church on the next morning, everybody was gathered in this little meeting room, and they were talking, well, tomorrow we go back to work. I heard the bluefish are running. You know, maybe we can get some deer. Anybody hear that baby crying last night? You know what? I did too. Who's got a baby? I don't know. Maybe somebody's visiting from out of town. So they kind of just shrugged it off. But Tuesday morning, now, when they came in on Tuesday morning, it was like, okay, is it just me or did that baby keep you up all night? And they're like, yes, what the heck's going on? Why don't they make that baby be quiet? Wednesday morning, it's like, baby, shut the hell up, will you? We can't sleep. And these are all adults. They can't stand that a child is in trouble. And they're helpless to do anything about it. Not to mention, it keeps them up all night. So, just coincidentally, another member of the town gets on his horse and he rides down to the little town of Virginia Beach because they have a store and he needs some supplies. So he rides over the sand dunes and he comes to the Princess Anne Hotel, and a bunch of people gathered all around the front of the hotel. Now he gets off his horse and he walks over to this crowd and he's listening. Terrible shipwreck. Terrible shipwreck. Captain's wife killed. They never did find the little baby. OMG, he's thinking, the baby. So he gets on his horse, rides like thunder, hits the ground running. Hey, up in town, a little baby, shipwreck. We gotta find him. We gotta find him. And so they all got together. They were gonna go search the dunes looking for the baby. He's gonna be dead if they don't find him soon. And they walked by the church. And the preacher was out there doing something in the garden or something, and they ran to him and said, oh, preacher, oh, if we've ever needed God's help, preacher, we need it today. What is it, my children? Well, there's a shipwreck and a baby. He's missing. And the preacher goes, oh, yes, I know about that. What do you mean you know about that? Well, do you want me to take you to him? Yeah. So he walks around back, and he said, I buried him here. And they just looked. It's no, you don't understand. We've heard him crying. It can't be this baby. And after a long silence and everybody wondering what the heck to do, an older woman spoke up and she goes, well, of course the baby's crying. I think I did that. Not at a good time. I'm just building up the suspense and then we have a funny note. I said, of course the baby's crying. He wants to be buried next to his mother. And so they exhumed little Carl, and they buried him next to his mom in Oak Grove Cemetery here in Norfolk. Now, that should be the end of the story, but it's not. Now, that area, the fishing village, fell apart and became Back Bay National Wildlife Refuge. And for years and years, it was untouched by man, just let completely wild, until they started having a problem. Two animals had gone crazy, and now the Back Bay National Wildlife was full of deer and full of wild hogs. Now, hogs were carried on most of the sailing ships because they don't require any special care. You can just stick them anywhere. You don't really have to feed them. They'll survive somehow. And the good thing about a hog is you can eat everything but the oink. So if you're shipwrecked or somewhere, you got, you know, a week's rations. But hogs are very good swimmers. So even if nobody, no human survived that shipwreck, the hogs will. And it only takes three generations for the hogs to go feral. And you've seen them. The hunchbacks, the razorbacks with the big fangs and all that kind of stuff. And so down at Back Bay National Wildlife, they're saying, guys, okay, when you get your deer tags for this year, we want you to take as many as you can. But also, take some pork home with you. You know, bring home the bacon. And the hunters loved it, you know, because, I mean, they were no limit on the hogs, and then they had to limit the number of deer. And word got out that this was a nice place, and it was kind of like, well, gosh, I wish I could take the family, maybe if we could picnic or something there. And so the powers that be rolled it out and said, yeah, we'll make a little day camp here. You put up some picnic tables, you can come and have your meals, that's nice. And that went on for a while, and people said, this is so nice, I bet it'd be great to spend the night here, under the clouds, under the stars, listening to nature. And so they did. They made it into a campground. Now, campground opens and everybody's so proud of this new park, pristine, no park like it. And they're talking to all the guests. Did you have a good time? Did you see the little family of otters out in the water? Did you see the dolphin? The mosquitoes, yeah, we know. The mosquitoes are pretty bad, but other than that, did you have a good time? And everybody's like, yes, we did. And somebody says, well, I don't mean to complain, but somebody's baby kept me up all night. And then other people started to complain about this baby. Now, the park rangers knew about the story about Carl, okay? But like I said before, in certain places, people with badges, for instance, if they admit that they believe in ghosts, they've just lost all their credibility, okay? And the story I was going to tell you before, I was stationed at number 12, SeaTac Fire Station. It was haunted. Irving Hogany haunted that building, but only the firefighters knew it. So I got a call from a reporter. He says, I'd like to speak with the captain. I said, that's me. Well, I would like to arrange to do an interview with you about, you know, what it's like in the fire department and your training. And we're loving it because we don't get any publicity at all, at least not in the old days. And so I called my battalion chief. He shut us down for an hour and a half, except for extreme emergency, of course. And the reporter and his photographer came in, and we're bragging about, oh, we do confined space rescue, we do aircraft crash, fire, and rescue, you know, we do high-level rescue, we recertify as paramedics every so often, and on and on and on. And so after about an hour, he's getting up to go, and he says, so tell me, is it true? There's what true? Everything we told you is true. No, I mean, is the station haunted? And, well, since he knew, and it wasn't well known at that time, we figured he had an inside. So we're like, oh, yes. And we told him all our stories about Irving, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Well, this was a reporter from the Beacon, or the Compass, or the whatever you get. It's the supplement in your newspaper. Okay, well, this interview was like on Tuesday. And in Sunday's Beacon, on the front page, there was Captain Al and his crew at the haunted fire station. And in those days, you could call the city manager and your city councilman on the phone on the weekends, and many, many people did because some nutcase was in the fire department. And as a result, there's a little clause in the personnel manuals now that says you cannot say anything about a city building having any kind of paranormal activity or being haunted in any way. So, like I said, I don't know whether to be proud or embarrassed. But what the Rangers decided to tell these people was, oh yes, we heard that. We know that is. It does sound like a baby crying, doesn't it? Yeah, well, it's a coyote. People didn't know any better. Said, oh, okay, sure sounds like a baby. Nope, it's coyote. Now, I call that the coyote story. And the park rangers don't use it anymore, but the Virginia Aquarium will tell you a coyote story, except it won't be a coyote. If you go out in the, I'm assuming most of you have been in the ocean off Virginia Beach, and you know that in the summer it's very nice, it's near the Gulf Stream, but even on the warmest, hottest days, you'll go through a cold spot in the water. Yeah, I see people nodding, yep. So if you go to the Marine Science Museum and ask them about that, they're gonna say, oh yes, that's a thermal bubble that does that. Coyote story. Okay. What happens in a room when a ghost comes in? It gets cold. So when you're swimming, and you're swimming through that cold spot, you're swimming where somebody drowned. No, it could have been good old Carl. It could have been those 14 men from before. It could have been any of 1,000 people. I got a very, I won't say hateful, but a message from a father who was upset because he'd come here from Iowa with his children and they refused to go in the ocean. After his special trip to the beach for the kids to go in the ocean, they wouldn't get their feet wet. Now, we're going to jump ahead here. This is the Princess Anne Hotel with the statue, the figurehead, the actual figurehead of the ship. This is what those people were gathered around. This is what they were talking about. And that became the city monument, kind of like what the King Neptune is to us now. Everything was the Norwegian lady. Here she is in the 1930s, all coming apart, arms gone. People would climb up on her with pocket knives and cut off a piece of the wood for good luck, which doesn't make a bit of sense for me. Take a piece of a shipwreck for good luck. Anyway, she's got a Band-Aid on. She's drying out, and she started to crack, so they put that little piece of brass across her and screwed it in. She sat out there for years. And finally, in the 1950s, with the invention of weather radar, they knew that this big hurricane was coming. She was off on this pedestal on 25th Street. And they're like, oh, the poor Norwegian lady will never stand it. I mean, it's been over 100 years. She's been through a lot of storms, but for some reason, she won't stand this one because we know it's coming. As a precautionary measure, they took her down and they stored her in the city garage, which at that time was a barn. Now, if you've experienced hurricanes here, you know we also get thunderstorms. This particular hurricane had a thunderstorm and the lightning struck the barn. It burned up and so did the statue or the figurehead. So now we have a new one. Now, oddly enough, in the early 1960s, we missed our Norwegian lady. And so we commissioned a sculptor from Moss, Norway, to create a statue, twin statues, actually. And they were going to be unveiled, one here in Virginia Beach and one in Moss, Norway, on the 27th of March when this tragedy happened. Okay, but that particular year, we had the Ash Wednesday storm. Now, the dictator was sunk on Good Friday. Now the Ash Wednesday storm is preventing them from putting up the statue. That was delayed until September. However, after the Ash Wednesday storm, the remains of the dictator were uncovered. You can see it there on the beach. Up until very recently, people that owned property at the beach had what was called, the land rights extended all the way to low water. So a guy said, I don't want this on my property. I don't like all the archaeologists coming here. I don't like the press coming down here, taking pictures of it. I don't like tourists coming down here, climbing all over it. So he hired an excavation crew to cover it back up. So maybe some year, some Easter, it'll pop up again. Now, that old fire life-saving station you saw in 1903, that was replaced with this building. That old building was moved across the street into Government Square and became our first post office. This life-saving station, you can see, is bigger. It has the tower coming through the roof of the building. And just as a little heads up, I will tell you that this isn't common knowledge, especially in the early days, in the early 1900s and such. See, we didn't have a coroner here, and we didn't have a public graveyard. So shipwreck victims had to be taken into Norfolk. But if you don't realize this, Norfolk is at a lower grade than New Orleans. And there's a swamp between us and Norfolk. It's all been filled now. But during bad weather, it used to be impossible to get from Norfolk to Virginia Beach. And so shipwrecks, well, if they survived and were in good shape, they would live with the families of the surfmen. And if they were injured, they'd stay in the life-saving station. But if they were dead, they had to go to Norfolk for the coroner and to be buried. But you couldn't take them because there was a storm. So you bury them. But because of all the feral hogs, you have to bury them 6 feet deep because the hogs will dig them up and eat them. And so what would happen? You've got five bodies. You know, it's got to go to Norfolk. It's going to be 5 days. That means you bury them. Then in 5 days, you got to dig them up again. And that was part of their job. And they did it without complaint. But sometimes when they were just completely overwhelmed, either by the number of fatalities or the amount of time they had been working, a body or two might end up in the attic, maybe overnight, wrapped in sailcloth. And that's just kind of an introduction into the next chapter I'm going to tell you about. In the 1933, the building was modified. The tower was on the outside. The big doors faced the ocean, as you can imagine, so all they have to do is pull the big doors up and pull out. In the 1960s and 70s, it was abandoned. The Coast Guard moved out to Little Creek, and the building was abandoned for several years. They were going to tear it down because they needed another hotel. There just weren't enough at the oceanfront. But the local people started a GoFundMe page. They didn't call it that then. They called it an SOS, Save Our Station. And so they managed to save enough money that the city said, okay, we'll spare the station, but we still want to build on that lot. So they moved the little life-saving station to the end of 25th Street, and they turned it perpendicular. So what used to face east now faces north. So it takes up smaller space on the overall ocean view point. But again, the local people, they felt very powerful now, and so they reached out again and said, no, what's wrong with having a natural area down here? So 24th Street Park was born, and the construction there is supposed to represent nautical construction. Surf and Rescue Museum now, it is haunted. There are two particular spirits I want to tell you about. I got to introduce you first to this gentleman. I'm sure you've heard of Albert Einstein and his theory about energy. It cannot be created. It cannot be destroyed. It just moves from one form to another. Okay, and another really smart guy, a guy named Albert Einstein. He was what was called a spiritualist. He was a believer. And one of the last projects he was working on before he died was a communication system that would connect the dead to the living. But he believed that our bodies, or all bodies, whether human or animal, are made up of what he called life units, little balls of energy. And it's not our soul, it's not our spirit, it's just what makes us run, it's energy, okay? So when energy can't be created, it can't be destroyed. When we die, when our body dies, these little life units go out. I want to introduce you to John Woodhouse Sparrow. John worked at the life-saving station for years and years and years. He's no relation to Captain Jack Sparrow, by the way, just a coincidence. John was there for the dictator. He also earned the Silver Life-Saving Medal for bravery on Christmas. He pulled two people from the Jenny Hall in the water that was so cold the waves were freezing. He was at that station until 1916, when the Coast Guard took over. He didn't like the way the Coast Guard ran things, so he moved on, went to a local hotel, and started working as a handyman. Now, John died in his house in Government Square. His house is still there. It's one of the few that are still there from the 30s. John had been in a coma for several days before his death. Now, John lived in his house with Vandalia Gorndo, his childhood sweetheart. They had seven kids. John had been in a coma. He's over in a little bedroom on his cot. Vandalia standing at the kitchen looking out the window, and she's aware of something looks different. She looks over, John sitting up in bed. Oh, John, John. She runs in. She's, oh, John, your hair is such a mess. And she's fussing over him. And John's just sitting there staring at the window on the wall across from him. Small room. He's looking at this window, and Vandalia's fussing over him, and, oh, John, I'm so glad. Can you speak? Can you speak to me? And he's just looking at that window, and Vandalia's looking over her shoulder, like, what is he looking at? And then he raises his bony little hand, and then he said what turned out to be his last words, and there's nothing famous about him, really, but he says, can you see that great white horse coming through my window? And he died. No great white horse ever came through the window. But the indigenous people here believe that when we die, a totem in the form of whatever animal you are most fond of in life will come take your body across the bridge to the happy hunting ground. John loved a particular white horse that was at the life-saving station. They even called it John Horse because he went out there and took care of it. But even though that horse came for John, John did not go. John is still in the building. You can just imagine him whenever there's these bad Northeasters, you can imagine him standing up on the tower. In fact, back in the old days, before there were cell phones and all this kind of thing, people would see John in the station at night after the station's closed up. They'd walk by and they'd see his face looking out the window. Well, no cell phones. They would either find a public phone or they'd flag down a policeman and they said, there's somebody in the life-saving station. It says they close at 9. There's no lights on or anything, but there's a guy looking out the window. So then the police would come and they'd have to get the director of the museum and he'd open the building and there was never anybody in there. And this went on for years, sometimes twice a month, sometimes once every 6 months, but it was constant. And so finally when they started, you know, getting better phone service, people would call in and say, oh, I see a face in the building. Was the alarm going off? No, but I see him. Okay, well, then they have to send a patrolman out there to check it out. So when they got to a point where they were going to start charging people for false calls, and the police came to the life-saving station and said, we know that you've got a problem. Don't know what it is, but but you need to find a way to resolve it because we're going to have to start ticketing you. So, being artisans and being creative, they found a picture of old John Woodhouse Sparrow dressed like that, like the Gorton's fisherman. They found that picture. They enlarged it life size, which for John was 5'2", so it's not huge. They cut it out and mounted it to a piece of foam core, and they put it up in the tower looking out the window. So now when somebody calls in and says, oh, there's a face looking out the window, do you hear the alarm going off? No, but I see it. We know about that. Thanks for calling. See, now they don't tell the people, no, what you're seeing is a cutout. We know about that. I also want to introduce you to Reuben Luther Wedwine, a Texan, signed up to serve in the military in the Merchant Marine. On June 15, 1942, he was part of a convoy coming into Chesapeake Bay. They were going to form up and then go across to England. They did not know that just a few days before, a German submarine had planted a minefield at the entrance to Chesapeake Bay. They wandered into it. This is the SO Augusta. The SO Augusta was struck. Reuben Redwine was in the engine room and was killed instantly. His body was sucked out from a hole in the side of the ship. Two other ships were damaged. One was obliterated by the mines. The Navy closed down all the sea lanes. They closed down Virginia Beach. And if you've ever seen pictures of Virginia Beach during the 40s, there were gun emplacements all up and down the boardwalk. Okay, so the Coast Guard goes out and they recover Reuben's body. Okay, now we have our own coroners here, and now at this point, we have our own public cemeteries. But this is a war death, so this body has to go to the coroner in Norfolk, Norfolk Fleet Command. Okay, so they've got Reuben's body. They can't leave Virginia Beach because we're in lockdown. So they put him in the attic of the life-saving station for a couple hours. And apparently his energy left him while he was up there. Now, nobody sees Reuben, but a lot of people feel him. Now, these little life units I was talking about. So think of a little ball of electricity. Think of what you can do with a balloon by rubbing it on your clothes and putting it next to your hair, and your hair stands up. Okay? Have you ever walked into a room, people have had a big argument, you can almost feel the negative energy in the air, and people will say, oh, the emotions were so thick you could cut them with a knife. Okay? So imagine what Reuben went through when he died. I mean, he's coming into Norfolk, he's going to get drunk, find a girlfriend, and have a good time. He's dead. So his energy comes out, his body's moved, and he's like, well, in my estimation, he goes up to everybody that comes in, and they're like, hey, can you see me? What the hell's going on here? I was on a boat. What's going on? Now, I've seen people as a docent and as a member of the board of directors of the hotel, of the museum, I've seen people come into the building, and the first thing they do is wrap their hands around their chest. They'll step in, maybe four or five people in a group, and this person will take one step in and go like this. Oh, I don't know, guys. This place gives me the creeps. I'm going to wait for you outside. Okay. There was one instance where a woman and her husband and child came into the museum. They'd been there about 20 minutes. Something on the second floor set her off. She was just crying inconsolably. Nothing anybody could say. Step outside. She was fine. But she wouldn't go back in after she stepped back outside. Now, I think certain people are sensitive to this energy. Here's Reuben, this frantic energy, running up to people. And sometimes they run up to somebody who can feel it, and they're like, ooh, you know. Now, I used to do my ghost walk nightly, and sometimes I'd have 40 people. But one night after the ghost walks, this guy pulls me aside, and he goes, I didn't want to say anything. I'm a priest, and I could have sent both those ghosts away, but then you wouldn't have any stories to tell. So, anyway, I think Reuben will be there no matter what. What happens to that building is dependent on Reuben finding the answer. This is Church Point Manor. This is back in Church Point. The manor house was built in the 1830s. It was a private home. Then it was abandoned. Then it was reconfigured to be a bed and breakfast. And then they put a restaurant called Cellars in the basement. It is profoundly haunted, particularly by a little 10-year-old girl named Mary, who has a room on the second floor. As I was doing my ghost walks over the last 20 years, a TV show became very popular ghost hunters. People would say, oh, do you do that ghost hunting stuff? I'm like, well, I wanted to be hip, you know. Oh, yes, I do. But then it bothered me that I was lying. So I actually went out and bought some stuff and went on a few investigations. And if anybody, I don't think I'll get in trouble. If anybody knows Corey Thornton, the guy who's here, he went on a couple of investigations with me. So, see, now his reputation is ruined because he believes in ghosts. This is a room inside. This is called Mary's room. And this is a little ball of energy. These were never a problem until they got electronic flash. So instead of being the flash being heat, it's electrical. So maybe the electronic flash attracts these little balls of energy and illuminates. I'm not saying that that's a body. I'm not saying it's part of a body or anything. I'm just saying it was unusual. This is the Ferry Plantation House. Without a doubt, the most haunted building in Virginia Beach. 14 ghosts there. Three of the ghosts, there's a ghost named Henry. He was a servant who used to go down to the ferry landing and bring the guests in, carry their luggage, and clear a path for them. And then there's Sally. I'm going to show you her picture. And then there's Robert, who was a little boy, and he's what you would call a poltergeist. He likes to knock stuff off the mantelpiece. Sally just appears. Henry, this house now sits in the middle of a neighborhood. Some new neighbors moved in, and they would come over to the house, and they'd say, are y'all being bothered by vandals? I said, no. What are you talking about? I don't know. Somebody's just moving our furniture in the backyard. And so several months later, they came back, and he goes, we can't understand. If it's not happening anywhere else, why is the furniture moved? And so Belinda Nash, who was running the Ferry Plantation House and who believed she was Grace Sherwood reincarnated, walked over there with him to see. She looked this way, she looked that way, and she goes, well, yeah, this is the path Henry would have made to bring in the guests to the ferry house. So he's moving the furniture out of the way. They sold it the next week, just based on that story. Now, here's a modern picture of the house under renovations. Like I said, we did some investigations there, and I was sitting out in the backyard one night, clear, not particularly cold, not particularly hot, just a normal night, and the little light thing I carry with me starts indicating that there's something going on. So I just started taking some pictures in the air. And at first glance, the picture I'm about to show you looked normal. But then what we do is when we get these pictures, we change the contrast on them to see if there's unseen things. And this is Sally, by the way. This is what we found in the picture. If I change the contrast a little bit, that goes away. But there's no explanation about that, why that would be there. Nobody was smoking. There were no fireplaces in the area. We were on the water, so there was no dust. There was no mist coming up. If you've been here long enough, Shore Drive driving from Norfolk into Virginia Beach, you've seen this sign. They decided that wasn't a very nice welcoming sign to people coming to to vacation here, so they took it down. I was running out in First Landing State Park. And as I was running, there was this girl looking out from behind a tree. But when I got to the tree, she wasn't there anymore. She was at the next tree looking out at me. And then a bicyclist. Now, if I was to ask you for a ghost story and the lady next to you said, yes, no, she doesn't count. She's just piggybacking on your story, okay? So I would have to get sources that were unconnected. So another guy said he was riding his bike down there. He had his head down on his, you know, 10 speed or 20 speed or whatever it was, saw a pair of shoes and a dress, laid his bike down. There was nobody there. Now, I had heard this story in high school. I went to Princess Anne High School. And I had heard this story the whole time I was in school. You know that February is our coldest month of the year here. We often get snow in February. We had the big circus snowstorm was in February. So the story was that this young couple left Princess Anne High School, Valentine's Day dance, to go down to 64th Street. There's a big, long road that goes kind of to nowhere, looks over the water. So what two young teenage children would want to do down there, I can only imagine. But this was Valentine's Day. She's all dressed up in her beautiful dress. He's got his suit on. He's a little anxious to get back there. He skids on an ice patch. Car slams into a tree. She's ejected from the tree, pinned between the tree and the car, and dies instantly. The young man has a traumatic brain injury. When he recovers, finds out that he was responsible for the girl's death. He can't cope with it. They have to move, have him institutionalized somewhere. So I heard this story all my life, and now people are telling me about this girl on 64th Street Park. And then, just by happenstance, talking to one of my wife's friends, they live on the end of 59th Street, right at the park. And they said, oh yeah, she comes and looks at our windows all the time. So my friend and I decided that we would go visit this park. Now that's just creepy in the daytime. So my friend Mike and I decided that we were gonna try to recreate it as best as possible, except it was October, not February. But we figured Friday night, big football games, people leave the football games, maybe want to go hang out, you know, so maybe, maybe. Since the old days, there's an 8-foot chain link fence at the park, so we had to stand at the chain link, and I'm walking around with a microphone just trying to get some EVPs, electronic voice phenomenon. So we're asking questions. Well, you know, we understand there was a girl killed here. Is that you? Is there anybody you want us to contact? And leave pauses between all of these questions to try to get some. We didn't get any. But we left our equipment there, and we went up to Murphy's for a beer, but it turned out to be about 10. And we came home too drunk to do anything, so we just picked up our gear and went home. And my friend Mike calls me the next morning. He goes, you will not believe this picture. And we had computers, so he sends me this picture. And I said, I don't see it, Mike. He said, damn it. So finally, he's like, you see this branch? And he described it. I'm like, yes. Put your finger on that branch. Now move to the lower left, half an inch. And so he's guiding me in, and all of a sudden it was like, oh, I see what you're talking about. This was it. I don't know if you can see it. Some people can't. And so I've got another picture of it circled. Now, before I go any further with this, there she is. And you see, there's been different, one was kind of greenish, one was kind of bluish, because we're going through all the filters and the contrast on this to try to get a more clear image. It definitely looks like a face. I got to tell you something about pareidolia. Pareidolia is something that we do. It's not a disease or anything else, but your brain does not like being tricked. It doesn't like looking at something and not knowing what it is. So if you're looking at something, your brain's going through its file, its Rolodex, its Google, trying to figure out what you're looking at. The one thing we see most in our life is faces. It's the first thing we see when we're born. Even though it's upside down, we see a face. Early man had to be able to read faces to find out if the guy he was talking to was angry or happy. Okay. And so we see one dot under two dots, we see a face. Pareidolia in a rock, faces in that lady's knees. Faces in that frying pan over there. Faces in this bumblebee. Jesus in the cheese sandwich. Okay. And then a face in the tree. Pareidolia. So I can't say whether that picture is pareidolia. Probably. I'm not saying it's a spirit. I'm not saying it's that young girl that was killed. It's just a neat picture. SeaTac Fire Station, haunted. Mayflower Apartments, haunted. Elevator stops on the fourth floor for no reason. Murphy's Irish Pub. I don't know if anybody's lived here long enough to know that before it was Murphy's, it was Golden Dragon. Tommy Yee and his family ran the Golden Dragon. One day Tommy felt ill. He went home and he died at home. His family ran the restaurant for a while. They closed it down and they started renting it out to other restaurants. Before it was Murphy's, it was five other restaurants, but none of them could survive because Mr. Yee visited and scared everybody away. He would go in and rattle pots and pans. In one situation, the guy was having trouble with his wife, and they were arguing in the kitchen, and Mr. Yee went crazy, throwing things around. Murphy's is still haunted by Mr. Yee, but he's much quieter. Shortly after they opened, a woman came to the door early in the morning and asked to speak to the manager. She says, have you seen my husband? He says, ma'am, we haven't even opened yet. Your husband's not here, I promise. She goes, no, have you seen my husband? Well, he looks at her, she's Oriental, he knows about Mr. Yee. He'd had some strange things happen, so he said, yes, ma'am, I think I have seen your husband. She goes, oh, he must like you. They did, however, Mr. Yee got a little out of control. They shut the restaurant down for 2 hours on a weekday at 1 o'clock in the afternoon, and they had three clergymen from different denominations come in to exercise and bless Mr. Yee's spirit. Now that Mrs. Yee's gone, he's gone too. When I went in to interview him at Murphy's, they had set the stools up the night before in a perfect line. We'd been sitting at that table. Nobody had been in there. When I walked out, I noticed that one chair was kind of out of place, so I took a picture of it. Look what else was in the picture that I couldn't see when I took the picture. A little orb. I'm just saying. Tautogs. Mrs. Wilson haunts Tautogs. She's not scary. She's just there to make sure that the staff is treating people well. Cavalier. Really haunted. This is a picture of some of the famous people that stayed at the Cavalier. And in addition to, I mean, these were well-known people. But if the Carnegies or somebody like that was to walk in the Cavalier, nobody would know. If this man walked in, nobody would know that that was Adolph Coors. When I did my ghost walks in front of a group, I would do that same intro and I'd hold up that picture and everybody would just stare at it. And I'd say, oh man, I'm surprised you don't know who this man is. He brought more joy to other men than anybody you can imagine, Adolph Coors. One day I held this picture up and this woman in my group stepped back, clutched her chest and gasped. I put the picture away. I said, ma'am, please tell me your story. She said she had gone to a wedding there when it was closed down. The only thing open was the ground floor and the ballroom and stuff on the main floor. The professional photographer took pictures, and everybody else came with these new things called Instamatic cameras. You didn't have to wind it up. You took out a little cassette and sent it to the drugstore. You could get it back in 7 days. Instamatic cameras. So when they all got together after the wedding, everybody was comparing pictures, and they had the professional pictures, of course, and then everybody had their little snapshots. Does anybody know who this guy is in the picture? Wait a minute, he's in my picture too. Yeah, who is that guy? He's in my picture. Adolph Coors, in their picture. She swore that she would send me a picture. I never got it. I'm not saying she didn't send it, because I believed her. I think maybe Mr. Coors interfered and intercepted it or made her forget or something. You can see that it was reported that he died of a heart attack. It's also reported that he died from a fall from the Cavalier, which was indeed his means of death, but he committed suicide. Last story, this one's personal. That's my last name. I was adopted. My parents were in their 40s. When I was adopted, I was 6 months old, so there's a great generation gap. My mother developed Alzheimer's, and my adopted father had always said he would never institutionalize her. He'd keep her at home as long as he could. He continued to travel. He would go to Germany, he'd go to China, he'd go to Russia. And when he'd come back from a trip to Russia, he called me. I was living in Kempsville with my family, that family. It's a different family than I have now. And he called me from Thalia and he said, you need to come over. I think mom's had a stroke. No cell phones. I'm driving by. I go by one of the grocery stores. I stop, call the fire department. I think my mom's had a heart attack, 3908 Thalia Drive. So I drive there, the fire truck's out front. She's in the bed, adopted father standing next to her, all the firefighters are over here, just kind of looking. Oh my God, it's the captain's wife, a mother. We got to do something. So no, guys, it's okay. I pronounced her dead. So now we had to wait, first of all, for the police to come by because it was an at-home death. The policeman calls the doctor. He said, nah, it's not unanticipated, you can go. Then we had to wait for the funeral home to come pick her up. And my adopted father just lost it. He just started screaming, I'm not going to have the damn funeral at the church. What do you think of that? I said, Dad, I don't care. I'm not. Nobody from that church ever came over here. Your mother and I were founding fathers of that church. Nobody brought food. Nobody offered to help. To hell with them. I'm not going to have the service at the church. What do you think of that? I said, Dad, I'm fine with that. Have it wherever you want. I'm going to have it at the funeral home. Good idea. Good idea. But listen, why don't you come home and stay with me and Linda, rather than stay here where you just lost your wife of 55 years. He said, I got to make a phone call first. So he went and called his girlfriend and told him that his wife had died, but that's neither here nor there. So he comes home to sleep with me and my wife. Now, she's my ex-wife, my second ex-wife. She wasn't then. So then she was kind of like my future second ex-wife. But anyway, we were still sleeping together, and our room was at the end of the hall, and the guest room was off the side of that hall, and then the hall came around to the kitchen. I woke up, and I've already got goosebumps every time I tell this story. I woke up, I'm dreaming, and I hear a voice in the church, in the church, in the church. I'm like, that sounds like mom, in the church. She's dead, sat up. Linda, sitting up in bed, her mouth is moving, and it's my mother's voice, in the church, in the church, in the church. So Linda, wake up. She's icy cold. Icy cold. And I know she's a diabetic, okay? So I had the presence of mind to get up and go get her glucagon and her blood sugar stuff and all this. Now, when I'm walking back down the hall, back to the bedroom, Linda is calling for my father by a nickname that Linda didn't know. It was a pet name that my mother had for my father. It was Totsy. So now Linda's saying, where's Totsy? Where is he? Where's Totsy? Where is he? Where's Totsy? Where is he? Blood sugar was normal. Later back down, she woke up the next morning, didn't have a clue. No idea. I never told him because I hope she haunts him. But anyway, they're both gone now. Thank you so much for coming out here tonight.